You could feel alone in a crowded room. You can feel alone in your addiction. You can feel alone in your marriage. You can feel alone in your classroom. You can feel alone when you're surrounded by people, because we live in a world where we often pretend like we're okay when we're not. And when we pretend like we're okay when we're not, and we put on this mask, what happens is we end up doing things we never thought we would do. So glad to be here with you guys. Man, so fired up for today. So excited that I'm here at Fellowship Church again. So back in the house. And I just want to say, thank you so much to Pastor Ed and Lisa. Your generosity and your love and your friendship. It's blessed my life. It's blessed my family's life. And thank you for being willing to have conversations that need to be had. Thank you for speaking into culture that needs to be spoken into. So thank you for your boldness. So I honor you and I thank you. Yeah, let's give it up for Pastor Ed and Lisa. Praise God. So like Ed was saying, him and I, about a year ago, we sat on this stage and we had a conversation about all that God has done in my life. And I'll just give you a real quick snapshot and then we'll dig into the Word of God. But I grew up in a small town in South Carolina, and in that small town, I didn't have a dad in my life or in my home, but it was a small enough town where I saw this man often, and it made me feel like, well, what's wrong with me? I had access visibly to see this man, but he didn't have, he wasn't in my life, and it was difficult for me, and I thought, well, if I become enough, I'll feel as if I'm enough. And I went on this journey trying to obtain enough of the world so that I felt like I was somebody. And I tried to be the best student. I tried to be the best athlete. I tried to be the best in so many different aspects. And that led me on a path of destruction. And it left me feeling like, man, I have everything that the world has to offer. Why am I still so unfulfilled? And then I found myself saying yes to something I shouldn't have said yes to. Like Ed said, I was formerly in an industry that I now advocate against. And while I was in that industry, I thought, well, since I'm here, this is now who I am, because I thought my behavior became my identity. So I thought I might as well do the thing that everyone, you know, was seeing me in this way, and I was stuck in this place, and I made enough money, and I had fame, and I had all this stuff, but yet I still felt unsatisfied, and I didn't understand, and I thought, well, I wrote on a piece of paper, here are reasons that I want to take my life, that I'll never be a father, I'll never become the thing that I didn't have, I'll never be a husband, I wanted to become someone to a wife. I wanted to become a husband in a way that I never saw expressed in my life. And I wanted to impact the world in a way that leads to positive change. I thought I disqualified myself from all those things, and I wanted no longer to live. And through a radical chain of events, I met this young lady, and she looked me in the face after I told her how bad I was, and she says, you're not defined by the worst thing you've ever done. And you're not defined by the greatest thing you'll ever do. What is true is there's a God that exists outside of time, space, and matter. And he has the final say, because he created you. He determines who you are. Not your feelings, not the trauma in your life. And those things are real, but that doesn't determine who you are. And it confronted what I thought to be true. And then she invited me to church, and I heard the gospel. It changed my life. And of course, I married that girl. And her name is Hope. And we've been married for almost 8 years. And we've got 4 boys. Yeah, praise God. Yeah, give it up for that. And we actually live in the Dallas area. So we live in the Dallas area, and I travel and preach, and I wrote the book that Ed was talking about, 7 Lies That'll Ruin Your Life. And it's really a recipe book for healing. It has an aspect of my story in it, but it has the antidote for death, which is the gospel inside of it. And it says, hey, I believe these lies and they nearly destroyed me, but I found the word of God that is the truth of God, and it overcome the lies that I believe myself about myself. And that's what I want for you. That's what I want for you. I want you to know what is the most true thing about you, and it's what God says is true about you. And that changed everything for me. And everything that I said I would never have, Ephesians 3:20 is real. God stands ready to do exceedingly abundantly more than you could ever hope or imagine. And it's not because of this prosperity gospel. That's just who he is. That is who he is, and that's what he does. And I have everything I thought I would never have. And I get to lead this organization called Momentum. And we want to set men free. We want to set people free from what's holding them back, because each and every person in this room, there's a purpose and a plan for your life. There's you know, if there's breath in your lungs, there's purpose for your life. And that's what I've dedicated my life to. But man, so excited to get into this. So I want to talk about intimacy today. And if you asked most people in today, if you say intimacy, more often than not, sex is going to come up. And while sex is part of intimacy, that's not what this conversation is about. Intimacy is actually proximity to God. Intimacy is defined by this close proximity to God. And it's really important for us to understand that. It's so important for us to understand that. And he's the starting place. He's the starting place. And I love this quote by C.S. Lewis, and I this quote is allow us to going to shape everything we see next. So we're going to hop into three portions of text in the Bible, and we're going to dig into it. And there's a really clear collective message that we're going to dive into. But this quote says, "I believe in Christianity is I believe the sun has risen, not only because I see it, but because by it I see everything else." So not thinking of like Christianity as a religious like institution, like my devotion to Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. If I see my life through my devotion to him, he allows me to see everything differently. So that is what intimacy is. Intimacy is me being close to God, me knowing God and him knowing me. That's what intimacy is. And the Bible talks a lot about idols. Rule number one on the Ten Commandments, make no idols before me. So what is idolatry? So idolatry is known and willful disobedience to God. When you know what you ought to do and you don't do it anyway. And anything can become an idol. Your kids can become an idol. Your job can become an idol. Good things often stand in the way of God things. That's the way the enemy works. The enemy wants to counterfeit things that God has made. Because if the enemy can draw you away from God, if he can get your attention away from not only following him, but if you're following Jesus, if I can just get you distracted, you'll feel discontent and you'll feel disarmed and you won't do the thing you're being called to do. So what is worship then? So worship, we just experienced an aspect of worship, but not all worship is just singing in praise. Worship by definition is obedience to God. Obedience to God. And we're gonna go through three different stories in the Bible. We're gonna see how three times that there's this disconnect, that how sin, it separates us from God. So Romans 6:23 says the wages of sin is death. So sin creates distance regarding your perspective of God, and it impacts everything you see, you do, and you feel. There's this disconnect. And that's why we're in the middle of this. We're the most connected generation in the history of time because of social media, yet we find ourselves being the most disconnected and discontent and lonely generation in the history of time. Mental health is at an all-time high, in that there's so many people struggling with so many different things, and I think if you're not getting what you need most, then you're gonna feel unfulfilled. That's most certainly my story. And this is, you know, two-pronged, where if you're not following Jesus, then you don't know who you are and what you're supposed to do and where you're supposed to go. But even when you start following Jesus, if you get off track, you'll feel disconnected from the one who wants to know you best. And you'll feel like, what's going on with me? And you're wrestling with so much stuff. And you could feel alone in a crowded room. You could feel alone in your addiction. You can feel alone in your marriage. You can feel alone in your classroom. You can feel alone when you're surrounded by people, because we live in a world where we often pretend like we're okay when we're not. And when we pretend like we're okay when we're not, and we put on this mask, what happens is we end up doing things we never thought we would do. So we're gonna talk about 3 points. We're gonna spend about 5 minutes on each. So default connection, distorted connection, and disqualified connection. So the first passage we're gonna look at is in Exodus 32. I love this story. John Brevere is a mentor of mine, and he wrote a book called Killing Kryptonite. And there's this chapter 18 of his book. It's called Phony Jesus, and it's talking about what I'm about to talk about from this story, where Moses was chosen by God to lead God's people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. They were stuck in captivity in Egypt, and now he's led them out of Egypt, and there were these plagues, and they split the Red Sea, and he led them there from this pillar of fire and this pillar of cloud, and they end up at Mount Sinai, and Moses is up getting the Ten Commandments. But all they know is this guy who they were following, that they didn't really know where he was going, he's been gone for 40 days, and they don't know what's become of him. So the text starts like this. So we're in Exodus 32, chapter 1. When the people saw that Moses was delayed in coming down from the mountain, they gathered around Aaron and said to him, "Come, make gods for us who will go before us, because this Moses, this man who brought us up from the land of Egypt, we don't know what happened to him." There's something there that's really important. Yes, he was gone for 40 days, but God's delays are not always God denials. Because when you're waiting, there's something that God has for you. There's something that God has for you in the gap. Because before you get to the place where God is taking you, or you get to the place that God wants to, you know, take you to, or whatever it is that he wants to do in your life, you know, maybe you're someone, you're like, you're pursuing marriage, or you're pursuing this calling, or you're pursuing what's next. How do I get there? Well, maybe you're in this gap in your life where you feel like God has stopped speaking. And sometimes God's already said what he needs to say, and you need to sit and marinate on it, because he wants to remove something from you, or teach you a lesson, or do something in you before he takes you to this promised land. And as the story goes on, the way that they respond is they end up making this golden calf. So verse 3, so the people took off their gold rings that they were on their ears, and they brought them to Aaron. He took them, and he fashioned them with an engraving tool, and he made an image of a calf, and they said, "Israel, these are your gods who brought you up from the land of Egypt." So they are literally saying, this calf that we've made out of these gold is this, we're gonna worship this. And not only that, this is the God that brought us out of Egypt. So how quickly have they forgotten all that God has done? Because of they got discontent in the waiting. It is so, how quick do we forget what God has delivered us from? How quick do we forget what God has done in our life? We are so quick to forget. And then we see verse 5, when Aaron saw this, he built an altar in front of it and made an announcement. There will be a festival to the Lord. And I want you to see this. So in the text here, when it says "to the Lord," capital L, originally when they were talking about making gods, Elohim, about 2,500 times, we're talking about the God, Father God, but sometimes based on the context, they're talking about a false god. But right here, when they say Lord in Hebrew, it's Yahweh. They were saying, we are calling this golden calf God. How does this apply to our life today? How can we understand this and apply this to our life today? Well, instead of trusting God and waiting upon him, the people chose to take things into their own hands and do things their own way. Have you ever found yourself doing that? In the middle of your waiting, you felt like, well, maybe I can figure this out a better way. Maybe there's a way I can speed this up. Because what happened was, is they created a God in their image and they worshiped it. And here's what I want to tell you. If you put something into the bucket in which you call worship, you're not worshiping Jesus. Jesus plus is not Jesus at all. Either he is Lord or you are. There's no in between. And you are not a good Lord. We're not. We don't know what's best for us. We don't. We just don't. And as it goes on, it's like we see Isaiah 40, 31 says, but those who trust in the Lord will renew their strength. I love the NET version. It says, but those who wait on the Lord's help find renewed strength. And it's important. It's talking about waiting. Those who wait on the Lord will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not become weary. They will walk and not faint. There is endurance. There's perseverance. There's something that you don't have in your own strength that you need from God. And sometimes when you feel like you know what you got going on and you feel like you can do it a better way, you feel so stressed out and so overwhelmed. And it's like, why is this so hard? Why do I feel, you know, so overworked? Why do I feel so tired? It's because you're trying to do something different than what God has called you to do. And it's so important for us to understand. St. Augustine says this, patience is the companion of wisdom. Anybody find it difficult to be patient? I know I do. I'm a dad of four young kids, so patience is short to come by some days. But there's just something there. It's like we need to be patient because as we wait on the Lord, God's going to provide. God's plans never lack his provision. It's just true. We need to just hold on to that and understand that. And before we move on, I think it's really important to see it was the people's idea to make the golden calf, and Aaron went along with it. As parents, it's important for us not to allow ourselves or our kids to be conformed by the world. They're to be transformed by the renewing of their mind so that we can know what is God's good, pleasing, and perfect will. We've got to say, hey, when we see something that's not right, we got to say something. We can't allow the world to shape how we think. We can't allow the world to shape how we live. We can't do that. So in the same way, Aaron was persuaded by the people to do something he knew he should not have done. Anyone that we oversee, whether it be people that are leading their family or a husband to a wife or a pastor to a congregation, we cannot be swayed by the world. We cannot be swayed by the world. It's so important because the world advocates that stuff and status and sex that constitute satisfaction, but there is one person and one thing that we can be satisfied in, and that's the person of Jesus Christ. And as we move into this next story, this is really a continuation of just disobedience by God's people because we're going to now hop into Numbers 13. So there's two different really styles of preaching. There's an expository preaching where I'm going to go through the text and tell you that in depth everything that's being done. And there's exhortation is what I'm doing. I'm saying, hey, I'm trying to encourage you because here's the text and this is what is happening and this is how we can apply it in our life. And I'm going to move through this pretty quick. So a lot of people, if you've been in church for a while, you know this story. So Numbers 13, 26 through 33. But here's what's happening. So they finally got to the place that they were going to. They finally got to the promised land. And when they got there, They said, okay, Moses is going to send 12 spies into the land and let's say, okay, we're at the promised land. Is everything there that God said was going to be there? And just know this, sometimes when your expectations are not met, that doesn't mean God didn't do what he said. Sometimes God had a better plan. So we get to this point in the story where, you know, they had sent out the spies, and I wanna jump to how they responded. So the 12 spies go into the land, they're in Canaan, and they're checking, is the land prosperous? Is it dangerous? Is there food? Is there everything there that God had promised would be there? So verse 26, so the men went back to Moses and Aaron and the entire Israelite community in the wilderness of Paran at Kadesh. They brought back a report for them that the whole community, they showed them the fruit of the land. So, and then they reported to Moses, they went into the land where you sent us. Indeed, it is flowing with milk and honey. And here's some of the fruit. So they literally had these like 20-pound clusters of grapes on these like gigantic sticks, like you would haul in like a giant hog. You know, it's like, hey, here's all this fruit. And then you would think, oh, that's amazing. And as the story goes on, they're like, yeah, the land is amazing. There's all this fruit. The land is great for farming. But there's these big guys and there's these walls. So maybe we should just go back to Egypt. It's like, what? You know, I'm just blown away by this. But then Caleb stood up and he spoke and he's like, hey, certainly we can take them. Certainly we can take them because he remembered. And that's, you know, that's the big takeaway there, because New King James Version, it talks about nevertheless. They said, you know, all of these things are true, but nevertheless. And nevertheless is a strong way to make a contradictory statement. Nevertheless means despite all of that, the message from most of the spies is the land is as wonderful as God promised, but we can't conquer it. Despite God's faithful promise, the people who are in the land are big and strong. Despite God's promise, the descendants of Anak are there. There's these really big, scary dudes. Despite everything there, everything being there that God said would be there, we can't overtake them. But Caleb's confidence didn't come in himself. It came in the form of what God had done. Because he was like, hey, do you remember the plagues? Do you remember when he split the Red Sea? Do you remember the manna from heaven? Do you remember the water from the rock? Do you remember the fire so that we could follow this fire by night, this pillar of fire and this pillar of cloud so that we can get to where we said we were gonna get to? And guess what? Everything is there. Not only did he lead us and protect us and provide for us, everything is here that he said would be here, but we're scared. Why? Are you gonna trust in what you see, or are you gonna trust in what God has said? Because that's what faith is. When it looks overwhelming and scary and you need God to get through it, that is the very place that God has called you to. So who are you gonna depend on? Your human eyes or God? And that's what's happening here. Because when you're feeling stressed or anxious or overwhelmed or hurt or broken, it's so easy to turn back. It's easy to turn back to what God has delivered you from. And here's what's true, and here's the common theme of this story, where God had delivered them out of Egypt, but he was trying to use his love and his law to deliver Egypt out of them. My story is that Jesus saved my life, but the Bible got Egypt out of me. Because there's something you need to die to that you used to find comfort in. And it's so easy when you feel stressed and anxious and overwhelmed to go back to the very place that had destroyed your life, because in a weird way, there's comfort there. And the last story I want to share with you is this beautiful interaction with Peter. And it's in John 21. And you probably know this story where the disciples are on the boat. They were fishing. They see Jesus on the shore. They had seen the resurrected Jesus, but there's been some time that passed, and now he's making breakfast on the shore. And they hop out of the boat, and they go to him, and Jesus is making them breakfast. And he asked Peter three questions. And this is what I want to land on really quickly. He asked him three questions. He asked him, do you love me, three times? And when I say, hey, I love my wife and I love donuts, they sound similar, but they're very different. They're very different. Very different things. So in English, my wife is an English teacher. It's complicated. It's a complicated language because one word means 50 different things. In Greek, in the New Testament, there were many different words for love, and they were very specific. So I'll just go through them really quickly. So starge means like the love of family. And then eros means the love of romance. And then phileo means the love of friendship. And agape is the love of God, the totality of God. And this is what Jesus is asking him. Do you agape me? Because Peter had denied him. Peter had did the thing he said he would never do. And I guarantee when if you would have gave him a lie detector test, when he said, Jesus, I will never deny you, he believed it. But you will do the thing that you said you would never do. You will go back to the thing that you had said you would never do again. That will happen. The game changer is the love of God. You can't change you, but God can. So Jesus is asking Peter, hey, I know that you denied me. I know that you wept. I know all this time has passed, but do you love me? Yes. But he's saying, do you agape me? I can't commit to that. I phileo you. It's like a brotherly love. I can't commit to agape because I failed you. He asks him again, do you agape me? I can't commit to that. I failed you, so I phileo you. And then Jesus said, well, do you phileo me? He said, yes. And here's what I want to show you. If you will meet Jesus where you really are, not where you pretend to be, not where you hope you were, but if you meet Jesus, you come to him where you really are, all your mess, all your brokenness, all your wins, your losses, everything, because number one, he already knows. If you bring your full self to the person of Jesus, he'll take you to the place that you could have got to on your own. He will heal you from the things that you feel like you could never say. But it's going to cost you something. It's going to cost you something. And I know we're moving fast, but I just want to give you this last verse. John 16:33, this is my favorite verse. And just to give you a little bit of context, so John 16:33, Jesus is saying, hey, it's better that me, God, leave so that the Holy Spirit can come, so the Comforter can come. And they're so perplexed. They're like, you're not this, you know, I'm coming on a horse with a sword. I'm going to wipe out this Roman Empire. You're not who we thought you were in that way, but we believe you are who you say you are, and we're trying to figure this out. Now you're saying you're going to leave, and it's best that we go. And in this moment, he's saying, okay, I've told you these things so that in me you can have peace. You will have suffering in this world. Be courageous. For I have conquered the world. Three promises. Peace is not something that you can find on your own. It's found in the person of Jesus Christ. In this world, you will face suffering. You will face trials. That's a promise. But you can be courageous. Why? Because he has conquered the world. Yeah. So I ask you this, just to think about, I love this picture. anava is this Hebrew word where we get humility. And the way I like to think about it is this you know, anava would be this circle. And in that circle, to get into the circles, right? So if anava is defined by this God-given space for you, not vaguely, for you individually, there's a calling and purpose on each and every one of your lives. There is something for you to do. Not vaguely, you. There is a calling on your life. But for you to be in this space for God to operate to the most optimal, most effective way that he can operate through your life, you need to be in this space. And fear keeps us from stepping into that space. But where do we get courage? Jesus. And then once I'm in this circle, my pride can cause me to believe, well, I made it. I don't need him any longer. I've got this. Guess what? You'll never make it. Glory is when we make it. So you need humility to stay in this space. And my question to you is, what do you need to lay down? What do you need to let go of? What is it that you need to be honest about? Because what's true is we're only as free as we're honest. We're only as free as we're honest. I need God as much today as I did the day that I surrendered my life to him. And surrender is not a moment, it's a commitment for a lifetime. So what do you need to lay down today to step into the promised land that Jesus is calling you into? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. Thank you for these pictures into your people. God, I just pray that you convict us of where there is sin in our lives, whether we are creating false idols, that we are putting something into our worship that's not worship at all. God, I pray that whatever it might be that we need to die to, that we need to let go of, God, I pray that you prune that from our lives. God, bring to the forefront of our mind whatever it is that we need to repent or turn away from so that we can step into the fullness of you. And God, I pray for the people in this room that you, as you're hearing this message and you hear my story, that there's nothing that you could ever do to disqualify you from what Jesus did on the cross. And if you're in this room, I want you to know this is true. Each and every person was created to live forever. But where you spend forever is up to you. Because God loves you enough to give you a choice. Love is indicative of choice. We need to be saved. We need to be saved. You see, Romans 3:23 says that we've all sinned and fall short of the glory of God. So because we've all fallen short, that means we're all guilty. And then Romans 6:23 says the wages of sin is death. So we're all guilty and we're all deserving of death. But guess what? There's good news that God came, God sent his son into this world, that he was born of a virgin. He lived a perfect life. He never sinned and he died on the cross and he didn't stay dead. On the third day he rose, solidifying he is indeed, in fact, the Messiah, the one who takes away the sins in the world. If you call on him, if you call on him. So maybe today you're in this space where maybe you've not fully surrendered your whole life to Jesus. And God is tugging on your heart. And you need to make that commitment. That you feel like you've disqualified yourself. You've gone too far. You've done too much. What is true is every little lie or every thing we've stolen or the lustful thought, it all disqualifies us from God. But the gift of God is salvation through Jesus Christ. And what that could look like for you today is just simply saying that you are broken and you can't save yourself. I'm a sinner that needs to be saved. And Jesus, I believe that you lived a perfect life and you died on the cross and you rose again. And I put my faith in you that your blood covers my sin. And I choose to follow you with all of my life for the rest of my life. I pray that you fill me with your spirit and make me new. And if you're sitting in this room and you feel like you've made that commitment in your heart and you're saying, hey, I'm a sinner and I need to be saved and I know Jesus alone can do that. I think there's something that is solidified in you when you feel a spiritual prompting and you respond physically. So I'm gonna ask in this room, if you're in this space where you're saying, I need to give my life to Jesus. I want to be made new. I want to be made a new creation. I need to be forgiven. On the count of three, I would love for you to raise your hand and proclaim that you want to give your life to the one who died for you. You want to be made new. You want to be forgiven. One, he loves you. Two, he died for you. Three, I want to be made new. Raise your hand high. Raise your hand high. Praise Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Heavenly Father, we thank you for each and every person that's raising their hand. God, you're looking at them and saying, this is my son, this is my daughter whom I'm well pleased. And God, we thank you for the gift of salvation. And God, we thank you for each and everything that you've done today. And we thank you for your word. And we pray this all in Jesus' name, amen.
Hi guys, thank you so much for watching the Ed Young YouTube channel.
That's right, and if you want to be inspired, encouraged, and challenged like never before, subscribe and click the notification button.
We believe this channel can help change your life.